for those signing in, just go into the chat and put your name and put your team. Or if you're not sure exactly your team code, put the club and the age group that you're coaching. If you do know your team code or your team number, go ahead and just put it in the chat.
Hey, Brian, go ahead and introduce the four of us there here, and then Jonathan gets here. We'll just add him in.
My door,
you don't mind.
Just close the door so I don't get. Okay, and we're going to tape this. So for people that are missing, you know, we want to get you guys out of here quick. You know, we appreciate your time. So we're going to start it. We'll start it now. And then for anybody who's not on, the meeting's being taped, we'll cycle it on through YouTube. We'll put it online so people can see it who need to see it. First off, I want to welcome everybody to the meeting. You know, for those who don't know, the Hollywood League is a very old league in Florida, probably one of the oldest soccer leagues in South Florida. I'm pretty sure that we have roots going back probably into the 1970s. So it's been around for a very, very long time. And we're just caretakers of something that's probably going to go on long past us. We are the only established, long-term established recreational league in the area. And we've filled that role for a very, very long time. And it gives our kids a chance of getting a little bit of a different experience than they might get if they were just playing an in-house program. So the Hollywood League really is something unique and special. And we do appreciate everybody here being part of it because you really are part of it. The Hollywood League is all volunteer run. So our board is voted on by our membership. So the clubs are all members of the league. And they have voted on an executive board. I'll go ahead and I'll introduce who the executive board is. My name is Brian Weissman. I'm commissioner of Pembroke Pines Optimist Club. I also serve as the president of Greater Hollywood. Our first vice president, he just got called back for an emergency. He told me he will sign in shortly, is Jonathan Carrillo. And Jonathan is also the director of the Police Athletic League of Hallandale. On the call tonight is David Ocampo. David is our vice president for protests and referees. So he's the person who gets basically the red cards and things of that sort, or a referee issue. David Hales, and he runs from the Miami Shores Soccer Club. Our treasurer and also really our resident computer expert and does a lot of our scheduling is Tom Tianich. He's with the Hollywood Wildcats. And Andrew Devesh, hopefully I pronounced that right, is with Driftwood Youth Sports, and he serves as our secretary. So as a group, we run the league's daily operations. We run it with equal votes. So nothing that happens in the league is except for maybe what David does with red cards. Everything has a process. Anything that comes up, any things that all the rules and things are voted on by our membership, and the executive board does the same thing. So, you know, your clubs control this league. Our membership, I'm going to read it really quick because it has changed a little bit. It's grown. I'll kind of go down the list how it's on the website, but we have Brazilian Soccer, Davie Police Athletic League, Driftwood Youth Sports, Hallandale Beach Police Athletic League, the Hollywood Wildcats, Miami Shores, Miramar Optimist, Pembroke Pines Optimist, Plantation FC, West Pines United, and through West Pines, there's another several other programs. I'll come to that. Weston Select, AYSO, Soccer Paradise, Bold Nation, and they're playing under the Miami Shores umbrella. Florida Fire Soccer Club, they're playing under West Pines United, and South Florida FC, they're playing under Miramar Optimist. So as you see, we are encompassing an area a little larger than Greater Hollywood. We've grown. northern Dade County, you know, and into southern Broward County. And basically what's on this online right now is a list of our membership. So Tom, if you want to do, you know, go ahead and start. You have a brief slide presentation. We'll take turns. We'll kind of go through this. I'm going to go through it kind of quickly because, again, you can review this. This is going to be put up on the on our website. So everything that's on here, you can come back and see it. The reason we're doing this meeting is because you're here. It's going to eliminate the excuses later on when somebody says, I didn't know, I wasn't told, I was unaware. Well, we're telling you now, we're giving you the tools and the resources to get the information. So by being in this meeting and getting the coach's manual, you are aware. So that's our way of being able to tell you later on if something comes up that you were made aware of it. We're going to talk about, you know, some things like the websites, frequently asked questions. This is also your chance to ask us your question. And again, at the end, we can say that we told you so, we gave you the information. Doesn't mean that we won't help you later on, but this is just to get us started. Okay, so going through the slides, game ready. The schedule is on our website, ghsl.net.com doesn't work. It's ghsl.net. There you will find a lot of information. Okay, 7 a.m.
Do you want me to do this? Because I wrote this up more as a reminder to myself. Yeah, you don't know what it means.
I don't know what it means. Yeah, so I'll let you do the slide.
So what I wanted to say on this slide is that obviously GHSL.net is where you find the schedule. Any games showing at 7 a.m. or on Christmas are not actual scheduled games. You will not be playing at 7 a.m. and you won't be playing on Christmas.
Is
those
Christmas
are the two.
February 25th?
No. I'll come to it in a second. Oh, 12. So those are the dates that those times and that date is not an actual scheduled game. We just have it as a placeholder for the game. The February 26th is there to remind you that the games have to be finished by February 26th, because that's the end of our regular season, so we can then seed our playoffs. Okay. The next part of the game ready is for you to know how to confirm your schedule, how to use God Pro. Can you even log into your God Sport, God Soccer, whatever you want to call it, and how to use the chat. The third component of being ready to play a game is how do we change the schedule if changes are necessary? And you already mentioned it earlier, Ryan. We can chat coach to coach, team manager to team manager. There are some things that you need to know, whether that's a home game or away game, because for away game, you might be able to just make an agreement with the other coach to do whatever you want to do. For your home game, you're probably actually 100% sure you're going to have to talk to your field assigner to make sure there's actually a spot for you to play that game and that it's referee friendly. But ultimately, all of the changes need to be going through your club reps. Only your club rep is who we're going to take your game changes from. And we'll talk about it some more later. Player passes, they need to be verified, they need to have photos. And we all know that no pass equals no play. We'll talk about it later in the presentation as well. Another part of being ready to play a game is having a game card or a roster and the fact that you cannot handwrite on it. Referee fees, whether there's a one ref or three refs, or maybe there's ref missing. We want you to know at the end of this presentation how to score your game and how to report any red cards or ejections. Again, we want you to have the opportunity to ask questions directly from us. And then after today, we want you to talk to your club rep. There is 153 teams, I think, in the league. There's no way five of us who are volunteering and running our own clubs can be answering your questions. So you need to go to your club rep. Most likely your club rep will already know the answer, but if they don't, we meet regularly and we have chats regularly and there's no point in me telling, insert name of the coach here, how something is done when we can disseminate that information to 10 or 20 or 100 coaches at the same time. So that's what that chat's all about. In previous years, we invited Mark Godwin here from FISA. He's a rec director of coaching for Florida Youth Soccer Association. He wanted to be here, but we wanted to keep this meeting short. So I wanted to apologize to him ahead of time and just give you his contact information. If you have any recreational coaching issues or anything to do with FISA, please reach him directly. Okay. Go ahead, Brian. I'll give you this one.
Okay. So basically, what he has on here is our timetable per week. And we kind of go on the same schedule week by week. So on Monday, you know, as a coach, you want to remember the schedule is fluid. right? Nothing that you see online is set. Games can be changed. Make sure your parents know that. You don't print a schedule and hand it out because you might be giving something that's not going to be accurate later in the season. So you always want to check the website on a Monday, see where your games are, start letting your team know where the games are going to be. And always you want to think to yourself, did I score last week's games? I think scoring, we'll talk about a little later, right? The QR codes, or is that when we talk about that now? You can score all of your games. So you should score them on the field. Your rosters are going to have a little code on the top right corner. You're going to take your smartphone, open up your camera, point it at the roster or the game card, same thing. It's going to open up a link. You can go in there and score it. Home team, away team, anyone can score a game. But a coach should do it, and it should be done immediately following a game. We will fine clubs for not scoring games because we need to keep the scores accurate. It's very hard to chase something down from a month ago. On Tuesday, that is the deadline to score your games. So by Tuesday, your games have to be scored from the previous, any of the games you played up until that day. If you had a game Monday night, score it on Tuesday. So anything you've played up until that day should be scored. That's also the deadline for your club rep to request a game change. In the Hollywood League and a lot of leagues, we don't allow game changes up to the last second. If you know you have a game to change, do it before Tuesday or do it on Tuesday at the very latest. We have to have notification in and an agreement between clubs on Tuesday for us to make that change.
And Brian, to clarify, that doesn't mean I contacted the other club on Tuesday at 5 and they didn't get back to me. So somehow I'm now entitled to a change.
You have an agreement to move the game. So you've worked out your behind the scenes negotiations to move that game. And that should be submitted to us on Wednesday. There's a form that your club reps are going to be sending to us. It's a web form. And that's going to tell us to go in there and change these games Tuesday night, Wednesday morning. And by Wednesday, the changes will be made. And figure by Wednesday at 1 o'clock, usually at lunchtime Wednesday, depending how busy I am. Again, I'm doing it at work or Tom's doing it from work. We try to make those changes in the morning. Worst case, I do it at 12 o'clock, you know, on my lunch hour. So by 1-2 o'clock, your schedule should be set on a Wednesday. By Thursday, you should be printing your game roster. Referee money, each club will handle that differently. The game rosters you can all print out of your GOT sport accounts. You should all be pegged onto your teams. And we'll talk about that later in the meeting. You have access to print your rosters. You should be getting your money ready. PPO, we give it to you in the concession stand. Each club will have their own procedures, but you'll have to have cash ready to pay the referees. And then Friday, Saturday, Sunday, we're going to be playing games. Now, of course, there might be a game on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday also, or another day that's not listed there. But generally, a lot of the games are going to be Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Okay. Our website, and this is where everything is that you're probably going to need from the league, is, like I said before, ghsl.net. Everybody is welcome to go on this website. This is not a coaching resource, a club resource. Your parents are encouraged to go and go on this site. You're going to find schedules, locations to the parks. Our bylaws are there. The rules are there. There's even a cheat sheet that condenses it. We'll talk about that later. So this is a website that your parents should all know about. Don't hide it. It's something to show. Ask your questions today, but remember, you know, we appreciate everything you guys do, but what Tom said is we're volunteering and this is a little overwhelming at times. So even though we love you, we appreciate you, we're probably not going to talk to you as a league. In fact, I'm going to tell you right now, we're not going to talk to you as a league. I won't answer your emails, and don't take it personally. It's not something I just don't have the time, and we have to do a certain chain just to keep our sanity and get through the season. We will talk to your club reps probably daily. We have chats going all the time. We're constant communication with these people. So you go to your rep and your rep can come to us, and we promise we will address your rep immediately, or, you know, within this relatively immediately. If you don't know who your rep is, go back to the website because all the club reps are listed. Your rep might not be who you think it is. The rep is a specific person in your program that has been tasked to, I guess, even if you can,
I'm in the wrong place.
You're right there. Okay. So these are the people, if you scroll down, In Brazil, you're going to go to Michael. And Davey, you're going to go to Ernesto. You go to Andrew and Driftwood. Jonathan Hell. You go down the list. Those are the people that you bring your issues to. If you go to someone else who's not listed there, you're probably going to the wrong person. You can go back. Okay, so again, only club reps are going to communicate. And that's it. After today, you know, we'll talk to the reps. Schedules are posted. I'm not going to say that they're drafts. We've been going through multiple stages of draft scheduling. This year, the computer system changed statewide that FYSA uses for each soccer association. They went to something called God Sport. I'm not going to go into any detail other than to tell you it was a complete disaster. They did a very bad software change. They took away functionality, ease of use. Nothing is intuitive anymore, and nobody knows how to use it. So we had a hard time scheduling games. We usually do it much faster. The process is not done yet. It's getting there. Everything for this before, you know, New Year's is kind of in place for the most part. But we promise you over the days to come, week to come, your schedule will finally work itself out. We're working on it every day. There's two 600, but there are games on there. They might move slightly. We may have to tweak things. There's 632 games listed, 153 teams with 14 clubs. This is the most clubs that GHSL has had in a long time. I guarantee you that there are mistakes. Tom says on that slide, the slide just disappeared.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Okay. You said mistakes are bound to occur. I guarantee you mistakes have occurred. It's they're in there. So you need to look at these schedules immediately. If you come, basically what I always tell people is we make mistakes and we know it. We try our best to not do it. But after a certain point, and that point's in like a week or two, whatever mistakes we make are no longer our mistakes, you get them. You're inheriting our mistakes because you didn't catch them. What I mean by that, if your boys U12 team is playing two games and two parks at the same time, that's obviously a mistake. If you didn't look at your schedule until February 3rd and realize this is happening on that weekend, that's your mistake now because you waited that long. And it happens religiously every year. People don't look at schedules. Look at this stuff. Find our mistakes. We didn't do them intentionally. They're there. Don't print and forget. Stuff's going to change. Home and away. Remember, a team could be a home team and an away team. That doesn't always determine where the game's going to be. Okay, in most soccer leagues, in a travel soccer league, if PPO is playing Miami Shores and the game was scheduled at the Shores, and for whatever reason, they couldn't play it. They told me, you know, we can't play the game. Can you please move it to PPO? They would come to our park and they would still be the home team, right? Because the home team has other implications. The home team would change uniforms if the colors don't match. There's different stipulations. Who pays the referee assigner or things of that sort? Who provides a field marshal? So the home team in soccer is typically not always where the game is. In the Hollywood League, I know your parents are often rec and they're a little bit newer to this. I always try to flip it. So if I brought a game over, I would try to flip home and away. We don't always remember to do it. We try, again, we're doing the best we can. But the reason I'm bringing this up, location is where the game is. Look at that column, says location. Okay, I don't care what it says in the home and the away column. It does so happen to match. Actually, it doesn't. Look at the Miramar Optimus game. Go down to game 380. Game 380 is showing Miramar Optimus as the home team. It's being played. Well, actually, it's being put.
Well, this is a festival, so therefore everybody's playing.
But, still
but I wanted to bring it up as an example.
Yeah, still a great example. The home team, the away team. Okay, so that game is not at Miramar Optimus, even though they're in the home team field. It's at Boggs Field.
So and it's not at Miami Shores either.
Yeah, right. Do yourself a favor. Train your parent, your coach, your parents, that to always look at the home field, the location. And those are hyperlinked. You click on them. They're going to tell you where they are. You can go to maps. Fill in teams.
Let me talk about there. It. So I have a couple of divisions where we could still use a team. So if you know somebody who has a girls U14 team or U13 team, I have a placeholder here. Right now with three teams, it's not the best division. We could use a team. We will take them late. We will discount if we need to. We won't charge late fees, but see if we can get another team in that division. The same thing with girls U6. So girls U6, only three teams, two Hollywoods, one Brazilian. It's not going to be the easiest of schedules. So I think those might be the only two, but it's up here in the team brackets. If you find any others, let us know. We could use a team. If you need a little bit of help pushing it there, this particular division, it's 4v4. You really only need four girls that are either U5 or U6, which is 2017 or 2016. I know Tommy tried to do it, but maybe you never know. If somebody has a team, we'd love to take it. U14, it's a little harder, but we'll take a team if you can get it. That's all I wanted to talk about on the fill-in teams. Some divisions.
Tom, the girls, 2008 team, what level? I mean, we have a team that's like half 09 and half 08, and they're playing in Division III. Is that too...
Let's talk after the fact, and we'll see what we can do, okay?
Okay.
Well, let's run through these slides and then go through.
What's that?
I'd rather let's run through all the slides and then we can...
Let's talk separately. Tommy, let's talk separately because we're just talking about three teams and I don't want to keep 100 coaches. No problem.
Guys, we want to answer your questions. Take notes and we'll go through the slides and then we'll be able to... We'll come back and we'll grab all the questions. Parent spectator behavior. This is a huge topic in youth sports. I'm not going to say youth soccer. I don't know if it's gotten worse over the years, but it certainly hasn't gotten any better. It's something that we deal with as a board, and it's cringy, and it happens, and we feel like we're disciplining fully grown individuals for making asses of themselves and doing things that are very unbecoming in a youth soccer game. We hope that nobody on this call becomes one of those into coaches, and we hope your parents don't become one of those parents. But we all know we have probably one or two parents on our team, and we probably know that they're going to be an issue during the season. We unfortunately have had to go to a zero tolerance policy. We really don't have any more warnings or anything of that sort. A violation of a rule which creates a suspension to one parent. If a referee sees an issue, they've been trained recently. They're not going to break up a fight. They're not going to go to a belligerent. They shouldn't go to a belligerent parent and try to stop them. They would have maybe years ago. Those days are over. They're going to blow the whistle. They're going to stop the game. If one of your parents is badgering a player, yelling at a player in any language or profanity, encouraging them to spit, kick, hit, anything, you know, that ends in an IT, something violent, where it's just generally being insulting, they're not going to put up with it because those things escalate. They're going to blow the whistle. They're going to stop the game. They're going to go to you as a coach, and they're going to say, "Coach, gentleman in red shirt is standing over there. He called me a blah, blah, blah. He needs to leave the field. He needs to leave the park." Our rule on that is sight and sound. So if somebody is ejected, they don't move back. They don't move on the other side of the fence. They don't go behind a tree. They have to be no longer in sight and sound of a game. It means they got to leave parking lot. If they brought binoculars, maybe they can see it. But an ejection is really an ejection. Does it happen often? No. We've gone through seasons with no ejections. We've had it where entire teams have been ejected. I mean, we've had things over the years. I've been doing this a long time, too long a time, actually. And a lot of us will say the same thing. It doesn't happen very frequently. Sometimes it's worse in travel than it is in recreational, but it happens and it will happen eventually. So if one parent is ejected, all parents will be ejected for the next match, which means all parents will be out of sight and hearing of a game, sight and sound. And that would be in all age groups. So make sure your parents are aware of that rule. It's not a rule that we created, actually. It's a rule that we stole. This is in South Florida United. It's in Palm Beach. It's in all the leagues. This is something that it's meant to police the sidelines. The intention here is if your parents know this and somebody starts getting out of control, maybe they're going to help calm that person down. If that happens, you as a coach have to report it, just like a red card. If there's an ejection and you don't report it, the coach will be suspended. So anything that happens, whether it's a red card, don't think that because nobody saw it, nobody from the board or was watching, if everything comes, I guarantee everything makes it up the chain. It's if something happens on this game, if we don't know about it immediately, we will know about it within 2 or 3 days. Guaranteed, everything. So just report what happens, and hopefully it just doesn't happen. What's the next slide on here? Okay, FYSA rules and your representatives' rules. Okay, so
what I wanted to say by this, some of the rules are rules that Florida Youth Soccer Association and U.S. Soccer passes down to us. Some of the rules have been in the book for a long time, but all of these rules are voted on by your representatives annually. They are encouraged to submit changes. These are not our rules, as in five of us came up and said, we're going to do this and that. Your representatives, your clubs decided this is what needs to happen for the games to happen and for issues not to be occurring on the games. If you have a problem with a rule, don't come to us. Tell your representative next year when we're changing the rules of bylaws and you want to play 17 on 17 instead of 11 v 11, have them propose it. It's not going to go through, but you know, we can try. The rules are basically our rules, everybody's rules. Right. That's what this is meant to say.
Right. At the start of the meeting, I said that we don't run this as a, you know, it's not run by any one person. Your clubs get votes. You know, most of your clubs have a vote in the league. They're voting members. So this is all something we work it through as we go. The one thing on that slide that Tom had at the very bottom, if somebody gets ejected, the clock doesn't stop. So we don't do stoppage time in youth sports very often or at all. Even in travel, you don't see a lot of that. So if we're dealing with an ejection and you're losing a game and now we eject and you know you're upset that you know 6 or 7 minutes are off the clock, we don't add it back on. The clock is going. Okay. Registration, rostering, and guest playing. Okay, some of these are the basic fundamentals of what recreational soccer really is. There is a distinction, and I'm not going to go into tonight's specifics, but recreational and travel do have definitions in the rules. It's not like it's a blurry line, like what's a rec team, what's a travel team. It has to do with tryouts, who's accepted, play time, the generalized level of play. Do you attend a tournament, right? I mean, certain things. Now, we have teams that are in the middle. Like, we definitely have some teams that do go to tournaments that maybe wouldn't compete in travel soccer at this point. But if you're going to every major tournament, you're playing Division II or one or two or sometimes even three, you have a lot of got soccer points, you've accumulated, you know, a ranking in the state of Florida, your kids are paying an excessive amount of trainers, and when I say excessive, you all can put your own number on that. You're probably not a recreational team. It's kind of like you know it when you see it. Not to say there aren't teams in the middle. At my club, at the Wildcats, we have recreational, we have travel programs, and sort of a lot of these other programs. They have recreational and they have travel. I have two separate programs at PPO. I have Piranhas and I have Heat Strikers. And I have a couple teams that are in the middle. So does Tom with the Wildcats. So we always try to do our best to make sure we're putting the appropriate teams in the league. But that's really what we're doing in the Hollywood League. So these are some of the rules that we use. We don't use guest players. Okay. We play with what you have. When you have a recreational team, one player, Johnny or Stephanie, one player can take a team from zero to hero. I've seen it before, especially in a true like lower division rec game. One player can turn that game around. You know, in recreational soccer, it's more for fun. Everybody's playing. It's, you know, some of these kids will go to travel eventually. They will move on to travel. But we're not looking for you to throw in a guest player and just go out and win the game. That's not the objective here. We want it to be fair to all the kids you're playing and all the kids on your team. We don't allow guest players. So it's the kids that are rostered on your team. You're not borrowing from U10-1 to U10-2. If they're on U10-1, they're playing on one. If they're on two, they're on two. And you're not taking a kid off your travel team because you're short players that day. What you roster is what you have. We call rosters game cards. It's the same thing. There's one per game. Every game has its own game card. You'll be able to generate those in your GOT sport accounts. Some clubs will give you, well, you should all have access now because the new system pegs it to the coach. If you don't have access to your team, your club rep is either made a mistake or they're not doing you a service. You should all have access. If you're the head coach, you should all have access to go in, see your schedules, and print your game cards. A game card will be printed and brought to every game. You read two of them. The referee is going to keep one. He's going to score these game cards, and he should exchange them. You should leave with another game card, not the one that you brought. If there's a red card, an incident, they're going to note it. They're going to put on there who ref the game. If there's a ref issue, we need to know who refed it. Should be three referees on a three-ref game. There should be one on a, one name on a one. But we want things written on game cards. We don't want things signed. It's not about, oh, great, the field marshal signed the game card. We don't care about the signature. I want to read the name. Because we're going to talk about field marshals, I think, later on. A field marshal is someone who's assigned to kind of keep an eye from the home team, kind of make sure things are smooth on the sidelines. If it's Joe Smith, I want to see Joe Smith's name, not a scribble, because the scribble doesn't do me any good. So again, you're going to take the opposite game card at the end of the game. There's no handwriting in of players. The computer generates everything for us. Got Sport will generate the rosters. Your players will be on there with the relevant information. So when you print that game card, you're going to see your team and the other team on the game card. So that game card will show both teams. Nothing is handwritten on there other than your signature, things of that sort, maybe the field marshal. If you don't show up with game cards and laminated cards, you run the risk of a forfeit, which brings upon it, you know, you lose your points, your club gets fined. I think we talk about that later on too, but it's very, very, very important that you bring those game cards.
Brian, let me interrupt this thing. So this thing that talks about you take the opposing team's game card, they look the same. So you're going to come with two pieces of paper and the other is going to come with two pieces of paper. There is a slight chance that you printed your game card on a Monday and right after you printed your game card, the opposite team just got a new registration and before the rosters are frozen, they might have added an extra player. So we don't want you to later say to us, hey, they had this guy number 15 on a team and there's no 15 on this paper. Well, that's because you walked away with the same paper you brought. You don't need to know which of your players were there. You need to know which of the other team's players were there. So when I, as a coach, give my roster to the referee and he checks the players in, he put check marks, maybe he writes a jersey numbers. You want to leave with that copy and then your copy goes to the opposite team. So you know exactly who was there. And this happens a lot and people don't know.
But you signed your copy, right? So you know which copy is yours.
Yes.
So that's one of the reasons to sign it. Also, if you added a player, I would maybe just highlight that player on the game card if it was legally added, you know, before the freeze, a new player signed up. Maybe just make it that way the referee is aware. Okay. Field marshals is something that's part of youth soccer, as long as I can remember, in Florida. This was here before the multiple parent ejection rule was put in. A field marshal is a person who is tasked with walking the sidelines, both sidelines, the home and the away team. They're required at all games. The home club must provide the field marshal. He should be present the entire game, not walking away. There should be someone at the sideline who's a field marshal. The field marshal should not be affiliated with the team that's currently playing that they're marshaling. It shouldn't be a parent. It shouldn't be your, can't be a coach. It can't be a parent. It could be maybe of a volunteer who's, you know, a high schooler who's got some hours. It could be a coach from the next game. Most parks are going to have staff out there if they have a lot of games running in a day. The field marshal generally is a club rep thing they should take care of. But if your club rep is not giving you a field marshal, there could be a problem. So make sure your club rep is doing their job by assigning the field marshal. If they've tasked you with it, then you better make sure you have somebody there whose name is not on the roster. Again, I don't want their name scribbled. I want it clearly written so I can read who it is, or David can read it. Improper game cards is one of the major reasons that teams get fined. They're called administrative fines. We don't want to fine anybody. Fining is not our goal. We don't live for it. We don't like doing it. But when you're playing with like 14 different cities and leagues, you have to have some, looks like we have a law in the state of Florida for driving the right side of the road. You have to have some enforcement Otherwise, it becomes the Wild West, right? Just understand why we do this. They, if you didn't have a fine, people would just not show up to a game. They would change games whenever they want. There would be no repercussions. Just like they're, just like the law, right? You know, it's so, you know, it's the monetary fines typically go to the club, but they're there for a reason. Improper rosters is very commonly a problem. We're not using NCR anymore. The NCR was a triplicate paper. That's gone. You don't have to worry about three-part copies because we're using the game cards. The field marshals have to be identified on the game card. The referee names must be legible. Players and coaches not participating must be marked out for service credit. If you have a player who is serving a red card, they got a three-game suspension. Okay, that has to make its way to David, or he's not going to give you credit for that suspension. So in order for him to give you credit, that player must be listed on a roster. He must be marked off in order to get credit. And the referee must initial next to that player's name or write in serving red card. Just take a pen, write in serving red. The referee needs to sign off on that. Make sure it goes to your club rep and they send it into the league within 48 hours of the game in order to get credit for that player. We got a blank slide here. Okay. Okay, perfect. Score reporting. Tom, is there a slide coming, by the way, on reporting of red cards? Do you have that coming up so I can skip that for now? Or Tom, are you there? I don't know where Tom went.
All yeah, right. I'm sorry. I muted myself. Yeah, I think there's a
red card later. Okay, so I'll okay. Score reporting. Club reps are ultimately responsible for scoring him, but we've made it so easy to score games with that cell phone QR code. You all can score them. Hold your phone, score the games. Home teams will get fined if games are not scored, but please score them. It's your own benefit. We do not accept faxed or email game reports for scoring purposes. Don't email us a score. What happened to the slide? They're like jumping around here. Okay. Do not email a game report to us. We're not going to score your games. You have to score the game. Make sure the reps have a system. 5 p.m. on Tuesday. All coaches should keep a copy. Keep a copy of your game cards throughout the entire season. Just put them in a stack. You can shred them when the season's over, but keep a copy of your game cards. Okay. Game change procedures. Like I said before, schedule is fluid. It's going to change. Basically, you want to reach an agreement with the other team, the other coach. Now, most of us have a lot of teams and we have a lot of leagues that we're playing in. Field space, don't assume, is always going to be open. You guys know how this works. You're all coaches. But just because you have an agreement to play your game on the 14th at 3 o'clock, don't assume there's a field. That's why you need to also get in touch with your club reps. I'm going to give it to Tom in a couple seconds. He'll talk about the chat. Have your representatives confirm the agreement, okay? And then they will send us in the change, and then we will make the change. Tom, you want to talk about the chat? Because that's something
we'll I'll come to the chat in a second.
Okay.
Go to this.
Okay. All right. This is the most expensive, well, one of the most expensive things that you can do is not showing up. If a team A does not show up to a scheduled game, then team B needs to pay the referee fees for both teams. You're going to get the money back. Okay, so basically, if you forfeit a game, your club is going to have to pay both sides of the ref fees. The refs are getting paid. They were assigned to be there, whether there's a game or not. So if you don't show up, if the other team doesn't show up, we would ask you to pay the referees, and then your clubs will reimburse you because they're going to get reimbursed. So pay the referees. The referee would need to complete a game report indicating the no-show. We're not taking your word for it. We're taking the referees. So the game card will indicate that the team did not show up or they didn't have enough players. They didn't meet the minimum requirement to play the game. There they may come and pay the referee. They may show up and pay the ref. They may show up with not enough kids and pay the ref. If you come and you don't have enough kids, you still have to pay the ref. Make sure it gets put on the game card. Give it to your league rep. Have them send it into the league. we will deal with the reimbursements afterwards. So we will go ahead and do the reimbursements. And then where are we now? This is the next slide, suspensions. Okay. The way suspensions are red cards. Yellow cards do not get reported. Double yellow cards are red, right? So a double yellow is a minimum one game suspension. You sit out for one, but reds will be reported. There's a page that you can go to on our website that is going to show you what the suspensions are. It's right there in top. It says fines and suspensions. And there's some old stuff on there. We left it on kind of so you could see it, even though some of these kids are probably like not kids anymore. But we wanted to give you an idea of what's there. It's going to tell you the name of the player, the pass number, the team, the date, the infraction, the number of games. This is right off of a menu, right? And you guys all know this, but this is not actually our menu. This is coming from U.S. Youth Soccer, FISA. If a player spits, they're getting six games on top of the other charge. So, I mean, there's just certain things. There's minor fouls. There's things that are more egregious. There's fighting. They could also be, certain violent conducts could be career ending. And we could put something on there so long that they just don't play again for a long time. It's all going to go on the website. If there's a fine to be paid, your club reps can pay the fine online. They're going to have to pay those fines. So maybe they're not charging you, but those fines are coming out of your budget to your club. Maybe they are going to charge you depending on your PPO. We don't do that, but some clubs might. So, you know, you would deal with that with your club reps. The only time we would fine you is if you do something really, really egregious. If you get kicked out of a game, we might put a coach fine. PPO won't pay those coach fines. We'll pay everything else. You know, we won't like it. But doesn't mean that just because someone else is paying it, don't think it doesn't matter, because it's coming right from your kids. We're all nonprofits, right? So you're hurting the kids in your program by generating fines that are unnecessary. Red cards have to be reported. We will find out if you don't. If you don't report it, it's going to be a much bigger issue. Both teams, I'm going to repeat this like three times. Both teams, I'll go an extra, have to report the red. If the red card was on the other team, you didn't get a red card, but Hollywood Wildcats did. You still need to report that red. Why do we want it coming from two sources? Well, what if they don't report it? So both clubs are going to report it. Basically, it's going to be a photograph. Now we'll take a picture or a scan, but it has to be a clear photograph or a scan of the rosters. We're especially looking for the one that notes the red card, but I want to see both rosters in case there's something on yours you're not showing us, it's on the other. And you're going to email them to redcard@ghsl.net. Is it red card or red cards, Tom? I think that is correct. Or is it?
It works both ways.
Both. Okay, so red card, redcards@ghsl.net. Do that immediately. Because in 48 hours, is it 48 or 24? I don't want to say the wrong thing. It could be 24 hours, it could be 48. I got to double check.
Let's say 24 and play safe.
So we need those right away. So email us both. If you really, really have to, there is a fax number on the website. Nobody has faxed us anything in like 3 years. So just send us those red cards. Failing to report it within 48 hours, it's $50 to report a red card. When it's the opposing team, that's the first offense. That's not even your team. That's not another. Then the fines go up 100 to 200. If you don't report your own red card, it's $100. And that goes up to 2 and 5. The referee needs to also file a game report. If the referee doesn't, they know this, we charge the club 25. 25 for failing to file a report seeking red card service. If your player, if you want credit, If you are marking a player out because they got a 3-game suspension, if you don't send us that game card in time, I guess it's just a $25 fine for doing it late, and you may not even get credit for the service. You want your kids back on the field. Send us those
In other words, do not wait until Friday at 6 p.m. to let us know that your kid served the red card last Saturday, because you need him to be clear to play this Saturday. we all have day jobs and volunteer work we have to do. We might not get to mark him serve the card.
Right, so
and with the new God sport, when they got marked to server that they got a red card, they are scratched with a red line on all the rosters. I mean, this is rec, so most of us are not playing tournaments or anything else, but they are scratched. And if you're a coach who got suspended in GHSL, you'll be scratched out red on every single roster, even if you are coaching a travel team.
Right. Good point. We are FYSA. We are an affiliate. We're going to report to FISA egregious things and anything really. So don't think that if something happens in the Hollywood League, it's not going to follow your player to South Florida United or to any other league out there. Coach ejections. What's new in the rules is coaches can now get carded. In the past, that wasn't even a factor. You couldn't give a red card to a coach. Well, now you can. Referees are well within their rights. A coach is ejected, sent off, dismissed from a game, will be fined, and the fine will be paid before the next game or no coaching. These fines are in addition to the mandatory minimum game suspension for any ejection and may be increased by discipline committee based upon the circumstances. If you get kicked out of a game as a coach, you're going to have a fine. You're going to have a suspension. If you strike a referee or if you strike a player, I mean, if you strike a player, you're probably never going to coach again. I mean, ever. So, I mean, your conduct is very, very important. We will protect the kids. We have your backs. You know, we want you guys to do well. You know, we're here for you, but we're ultimately going to protect the kids. So, you know, please, please make sure your conduct is becoming. The only way to receive a credit is to send in a roster. It's not the referee's job. It's not our job to chase it down. It's not anybody else but you. You're the ones that have to get us that information to your players.
Brian, the reason why I added this 2, 3, 4, and 5, I get a lot of, in a different league, I have Davey's job of, you know, deciding, well, reading the rules is how many suspensions somebody gets. And I get sent a report that says, well, this kid served it, but my referee forgot to mark it. No, referee didn't forget to mark it. You forgot to mark it, and you forgot to go to referee before the game and say, referee, now that you checked my 14 players, you see this guy number 15 that scratched red? He's not here. He's not going to play. Please sign right now before the game that he's not playing this game. Right. If you leave that game, don't tell us the referee didn't do his job. You didn't do your job. I'll be honest with you. When my older kids get a red card, I tell them, go to the game and make sure that your coach doesn't forget to get your service, because ultimately you care to play more than maybe coach does. So that's what this is meant to say.
Well, one thing too, it's kind of like a test. When you hand a test into a professor, you can't go back and take the test back and change it. You've handed it in. We expect all these markings to be done before you give the roster to the referee. Once the referee gets the roster, it's his roster. If you didn't put your field marshal on there, even though your field marshal was sitting there all day long or all game long, you may not get credit for it. Get this stuff on the rosters before you give it to the referee. He doesn't have to give anything back to you. Don't assume he's going to. Okay, so additional requirements, suspension service. Players serving suspension must be on the roster, and they must be in the maximum number of players. So in older divisions, you can play 20, you can have 22 kids on an 11v11 roster. Only 18 can play in the game. So you can't take a roster that has 22 kids on it, cross down to have 18 playing, and have the 19th kid serving a suspension. It has to be the player that's serving suspension must be in that 18 of eligible players. Okay, so hopefully that's clear. They have to be one of those eligible players. They can't be one that's on the roster but not playing anyway. Coaches serving suspension must be one of the coaches. Okay, so you can't serve a suspension as a coach by going to another game. Okay, you have to be one of those coaches on that game's roster in order for you to get credit. Rosters cannot be modified. You can't add additional lines. You can't alter them. We could, you know, we'll levy fines. They're not required to be at the game in which your players don't have to come to the game, or the coach, you know, actually prefer they don't.
Coach is not allowed to come to the game.
Not allowed, right. Coach is out of sight and sound. The players can be there. but they really should be wearing a penny. Maybe they shouldn't be in cleats just to keep it. So there's nobody giving you any comments. They can come to the game. They can sit on the bench, but they should be less dressed to play. They should maybe not have their cleats on, wearing a penny. If you put them in the game, you're suspended for a substantially a long time. Coaches are not permitted to be at a game in which they are serving. That's what Tom just said. Sight and sound is the standard that we use. They cannot be communicating remotely via electronics. You can't have them on FaceTime. They can't be coaching electronically. All games must be served in full-sided matches. You 11v11, you 12. And it has to be with the team in which the ejection has occurred. So you got to serve with that team. A coach cannot coach any team until their suspension is served. If they coach three teams, they get suspended on one. Until they serve that suspension, they can't coach any team. Okay, do not alter rosters. We said that already. Mark which club is part affiliate to do so, we find. So basically,
everything we talked about.
Yeah, we talked about that already. Okay, there's no such thing as a friendly in soccer. And that's actually true in FYSA. If you're playing another team and you're using FISA insurance, you're using FISA passes, it's a game. If you're scrimmaging another team, I don't know how often this happens. If you're scrimmaging another team and a kid gets a red card, that red card can go into the league. Be aware of that. I mean, that's 100% in the rules. There's no such thing as a friendly, unless it's officiated by a coach. If you have a referee out there, you're doing a friendly game, you got to follow all rules and regulations. If you get a red card in a scrimmage, that red card is going to get served in the next official match. If it's a forfeit, you don't show up, it's going to be a 4-0 loss for your team. If both teams don't show up, it's going to be 0-0. No points will be awarded, but a lot of fines will be levied. I think it's a $200 fine. We'll get to that. Player passes, which will be given to you by your clubs, must be laminated. The system changed this year. Make sure they're signed electronically, probably, but make sure there's a signature on them. By lamination, I mean heat seal lamination. If you bring to a game passes and you have clear packing tape on either side, that's not going to be considered laminated. So they have to be heat pressed, laminated, or there's some other sticky lamination. Tape is not lamination. I'm saying that because I've seen it. Three carded coaches are in the technical area. That's all you're allowed according to the rules. You can't have the four coaches. The technical area, you guys can look that up. It is a specific area, but it basically means you're on your side of the field. You're not crossing the half line. Okay, so I don't care where your team is attacking. They can be down on the far left. You're on the right. You're not following your team to the goal. None of your coaches are. You're staying on your half the field. That half line is your end line to where you can move. And it says again, do not modify roster. We said it like 7 times, which is...
So this modifying the roster comes back to when you get a red card.
Oh, wait.
And then you're going to send it in, and then you realize you don't have a field marshal. And then on a Tuesday, right before you send it in, you write in a field marshal.
You don't do that.
It won't be on the other roster. The other club will not have it on their roster. We're going to have their copy. Don't
and the referee, alter the roster. The referee is going to take a picture anyway and send them in. So don't put – or don't – and also when you send in roster – sometimes I get this. Like a roster will come to me. The referee will write down a little explanation for what happened. I don't care what your – story is like, so the referee will say there was an egregious foul, foul from behind. Don't write a little thing on the side by saying the referee's wrong, this didn't happen. Just don't do it. We're not going to read it. Casts are not permitted even if they're padded. That's an insurance regulation through FISA. No jewelry, even if taped, except for a medical alert bracelet. Tell your players, pierce nothing between now and the end of the season because they won't get to play with jewelry. I used to say, tell your girls, don't pierce anything. Tell the boys, don't pierce anything. I don't just mean ears. It could be a piercing that we don't see. Pierce nothing. because, well, two things. They're not going to let him play. And I've been doing this for a long time, and I've primarily coached and been involved on the girls' side. I have sent girls to the ER to have their ears stitched back. It's not pretty when you see an ear open, and it has happened because they actually, one time it happened, they weren't even wearing earrings because it, you know, the ear was weakened. No jewelry, no necklaces, nothing like that. Adequate shin guards. If your U14 is wearing the same shin guards when they were U6, they're not wearing adequate shin guards. They have to be the proper ones. Shin guards need to be inside of the socks. They should not be outside the socks. Referee fees are paid before the game starts. The referees generally are not going to start the games anyway, but if you don't have the money, go to a parent and find it, but get the refs paid before the games. You have a 15-minute grace period. If you don't have enough players, or you don't, then the game could be forfeited after 15 minutes. Once you have enough players to start the game, we're going to start the game. So on an 11v11, when your seventh player comes running out of the parking lot, madly rushing onto the field, we're starting as long if it's 14 minutes or 1 minute in. Even if it's at game time, if you have 7 players, we're going to start. We don't care that your three best players are 6 minutes away, right? The game starts when you have enough players. And the 15-minute grace period clock starts at game time. Remind your parents, and I told my coaches this already, the date, the times you're seeing on the website are not suggested times of arrival. This is recreational soccer. Those are not suggestions. That's when the whistle blows and the clock starts. We're running busy days back to back to back. We're going to go from one game to another. Have your parents there whatever you want early. If, you know, on most of my teams, I tell my coaches, if they're a half an hour early, they're probably still late. So get the kids there early. Should the referee decide that the uniforms are not distinguishable, you're both wearing red or something along those lines, it's the home team's responsibility to provide an alternate jersey. The alternate jersey could be a penny, and it often is in rec soccer, but it's always going to be the home team that has to switch.
So let me cover these last two. Let me do the last one first. So one of the good things about chat in God Sport is you can chat ahead of time. When you confirm your game, you can say, hey, we'll be wearing white. And if a guy says, oh my God, we're wearing white too, then you know already you got to prepare. Don't forget pennies at home.
Right. But a lot of teams have one uniform. So
it's, yeah, whatever. Yeah. 15-minute grace period is very limited. It really means you're waiting for some reason for your roster, your player passes, your referee money, your coach to arrive, and the last of the 7 players. It doesn't mean anything else. It doesn't mean I got 14 more minutes to warm up or anything like that.
Right.
Yeah, exactly. I'm gonna wait because whatever we talked about earlier.
That's a good point. All games are completed at halftime. If you are losing by a goal and the lightning alarm goes off, and you're 30 seconds into the second half of the game, and maybe we wait to require 20 minutes and the thing doesn't reset, you have lost the game. The game will not get replayed. Okay, so that's not our rule. That is soccer. That is, you know, youth soccer everywhere. Halftime determines the game. Whoever's winning at halftime, if the game does not continue, that will be the winner. There's no replays. If we have to replay a non-completed half, so let's say you only get to play the first quarter, there's a rain out. We're not coming back and finishing the game. We're starting it all over again. So if we played, you know, let's say I've had lightning alarms go off 1 minute before the halftime. When we come back and we replay it on another day and we're paying the referees over again, they're not the same refs necessarily. We got to pay for them again, bring new rosters. Everything starts from scratch. It's a new game. We do have a mercy rule. After the first half is completed, an 8-point differential, it's got to be a spread of 8 points, that will end the game. We consider it complete. Referees should not continue on with friendlies. There's no friendlies, right? When you hit a mercy rule, the game should end. Please don't tell the referee, oh no, but we still wanted to play. We're willing to, our kids are learning. We want to take the loss. There's liability issues on that. Remember, we're insured. we guys are working with FISA. They have our backs with insurance policies, substantial ones. If you're down 9-0 and there's a mercy rule called, just leave. At that point, end the game. Don't ask the referee to keep playing.
The games are scored with a maximum of four goal differential. So right. If you want the game to play, then before you get to 6-0, 7-0, manage your game. You know, do whatever you need to do if you want the game to go on, but right. Don't get there.
Because, I'm going to get so many complaints on that. You're going to look at your standings.
Yeah.
And I'm going to get an email. And it's going to be, I beat the Wildcats by 8 goals and they only gave me 4 goals on my thing. We don't, after 4-goal differential, that's all you're getting in standings. When we stand, there's different ways in how we put teams into standings. First, it's points, 3 points for a win, 1 point for a tie. But then we have head-to-head matchups, goals for, goals against, goal differential. 4 is all you're going to get. Okay, the end of season dates and playoffs. Regular season's games should be completed by February 26th. Spring break is early this year. We expect playoffs to go the week of March 4th to start. It'll be at various GHL parks. We'll talk about that later on. It'll all be, it'll be a good experience. Real quick, U6, U8, you're going to have a jamboree. It's going to be 2 fun games of similarly seeded teams. You're not going for a trophy. You're going for a medal. You're going to get a hot dog and a bounce house. So those kids will go to a jamboree. You 10 and up, you're going to go to single elimination playoffs. Your rosters freeze. And we're getting through this. We're almost done. The roster freeze date, end of January. We're going to let your reps know. There will come a time, though, when you can't add another player. The reason why we do that, remember I said one player can change an entire team. You could be losing every game. I have lost every game in my coaching rec. You pick up Johnny and you start winning every game because Johnny is just really a travel player on a rec team and he takes the ball and he scores. After that date, you can't add players. Very, very few exceptions. Would we make an exception? Well, probably not, unless your team has like no players on it and we just need to keep you guys going, but don't expect it. Final remarks, and this is really important. I kind of want to say the tone of what I've been saying during this meeting, I feel sometimes when I do these meetings, I've been doing these things for years, and usually they're in person. I always come back and say, man, I kind of sounded like an ass that entire meeting because I was being kind of, I had to talk down and give people all these rules. That's not my intention, and nor is it Tom's or anybody else on our board. We're not trying to do that. So don't take anything I'm saying as directed to you. Don't take it personally, because hopefully none of these things are going to happen as bad things. I'm just trying to kind of lay it out there because one of you is going to be a problem. I guarantee it, but 100 of you are going to be great, or maybe 98 of you are going to be great. So, you know, again, don't take it the wrong way. But be a role model. Just realize that, you know, what you're doing is special. If you're coaching your own kids, they're going to remember this for the rest of their life. It's either going to be a great memory, or it's going to be a terrible one. Make it a great memory. Go out there and have an impact on these kids. My kids, I mean, my son back here is my soccer commissioner now. He's 25 years old. He grew up playing youth sports. My girls are in college. They played. My kids aged out. So, you know, and I'm still doing this because I'm doing it for the kids and, you know, somebody has to do it. And every one of these guys who is a director of a club, I see Jose Reyes on the call and, you know, other people, we're doing this because we're doing it for the kids, right? And we're volunteering a whole lot of hours and we're trying to make an impact. You're making just as much as an impact on your team. You're doing actually more because you're influencing those 11 kids on a direct basis. We're just kind of guiding you through the process, but you're going to potentially really help these kids. Work hard, bring success. And Tom had a good slide up there. You probably all saw it.
Okay. I promise people we'll be done in 45 minutes and we haven't even gotten halfway through. I deleted a lot of slides. So I'm going to really fly through this section.
This is the stuff that I'm going to turn over to Tom because this stuff. And Tom, kind of blow through these. They can go back.
I'm gonna have to blow through these. I will never go home. This is going to be posted on GHSL.net, so you can read it later. And if you see anything on these next slides that I fly through, please feel free to ask questions at the end. But I don't want to read the slides for you guys. Okay. and this is one of those, and this is another one of those.
All these slides are on our website. And
build out line for anybody who is a professional soccer player that has never coached little kids. Build out line is halfway between penalty area and a halfway line. The build out line is to promote playing from the back. And when a goalkeeper has a ball in their hands, everybody from the opposite team has to retreat past the build out line and stay there until the ball is put back in play, which is either kick of the ball on a goal kick or releasing it from their hands on when the goalkeeper has possession in their hands. If the opposite team crosses the build out line before the ball is put back in play, it is not a retake of the goal kick. It is indirect free kick from wherever the infraction occurred.
If you don't know what a build-out line is, really reach out to your clubs because you need to start coaching that. Don't be afraid to ask these questions. These are newer rules. These are not
way too many referees redo the kick. It's indirect from wherever it happened. We do not allow punts in 7v7 anyway. So if there is a punt, it's also an indirect or drop kick or any kind, indirect free kick from there. So teach your goalkeepers at 7v7 age to distribute the ball some other way. The offside in 7v7 happens not only up to the halfway field, but also up to the build-out line. So in this particular case, this player over here, A, is offside because not only has she passed the halfway line, she also passed the build-out line of opposite team. And now, even though normally this would be an offside, because she is on this side of the build-out line, she is not offside. I'm just flying through these. Does a goalkeeper have to wait before they retreat? No, they don't. But if they don't and the opposite team gets a ball, then it's they did it at their own peril.
Once that ball hits the ground, it's in play. Once that keeper puts the ball down, it's in play.
No drop kicks, bounce volleys of any kinds allowed in 7v7 game. I don't even know what this says. We'll move on. 8 yards. So because of the fact that this is smaller field, some of the stuff is shorter. So you might not see referee count 10 yards. They might count 8 yards. And that's because it's a smaller field and 10 yards might be on the other side of the field. We don't have a goal-to-goal rule in 7v7 because we do have it in U12, 9v9. And that's 7v7. 9v9, again, I'm going to fly through this because I don't want to read all of this stuff for you guys.
Oh, cool. Can we isolate these slides on the website so it's not in the video? We can put the slides on too, right?
No. So this whole presentation will be on our website tomorrow.
Okay, good. You can flip through the slides.
Yes. A U11 player can play in a U12 since there's no heading in U12. Okay. GHSL rule, goal to goal, applies in 9v9, which basically means if the goalkeeper punts the ball, which at U12 they're allowed to do, from one penalty area to the other, it's an indirect free kick to the opposite team from a halfway line. And here is a comparison between what's at 7v7 and what's at 9v9. I flew through this. Normally we do this much slower, but most of you have seen it multiple times and you can read it on our website. It's not dismissal timing, I'm sorry, but this is just the last slide. All right, so now we go to the actual website. So our website is Greater Hollywood Soccer League, ghsl.net. On the bottom of the main page is where referee fees are. On the right side is a cheat sheet. This cheat sheet will basically give you almost everything you need to know. We didn't laminate them, we didn't print them this year because, you know, COVID or whatever. We strongly recommend you print some of these and have them for your referees. U6 and U8 play 4v4. U8 7v7, known as U9 future stars, and U10s play 7v7. U12s play 9v9, and then U14s and U17s play 11v11. Our special U19 division plays 5v5 because we don't have that many kids. Again, this is on our website. It's on the cheat sheet.
And I more than encourage it. Print those, laminate them. You know, carry that with you. It'll save you down the road.
The full rules, the whole book, has been updated, and you can read it at your own leisure. Anything marked with a soccer ball is probably something you want to pay attention to. Anything that's not marked with a soccer ball is still good read, but a lot of it is administrative that, you know, we as reps work with. So if you just fly through this and just read the stuff that has a ball, a lot of this stuff got updated just last couple of days. especially because for the first time we have 4v4 U8s. The most important page is towards the end, and it's the fines, because this is where you find out how much is it going to cost you to violate certain things within a rule. That's our website. The most important thing on our website is GHSL 2021-22 schedule, which basically takes you to God's sport schedule. You can come back to our website with a website button. Home button takes you to this main page. The fields button shows you all the fields. I still see some fields missing here. So if you are a rep whose club's fields are not showing here, we really need to talk. I've been saying this since August, but we did have some new clubs join us last minute. You can look up all of the schedules for particular club fields by clicking on a schedule. So for example, Hollywood West Park, if you click on the schedule, you will see all of the game played in Hollywood West. If you want the address to the field, you just need to click on Hollywood West. It will show you where it is located. It will show it to you on a map, and it will even show you subfields on Hollywood West. So that's the fields. The registration button doesn't do anything anymore unless you're one of those clubs who wants to send us U14 girls or U6 girls. On the clubs tab, you have all of the clubs that participate and all the teams within the club. So if I click on Davy Powell, it's going to show us they have three teams, and each of these will take them to their team's schedule. And here is the schedule just for that one team, including the standings for that division on top. On the bottom of the this particular club's page, all the nobody's there. Let me find another club. On the bottom of the club's page are the contacts for everybody within the club that's in the system. If you cannot get hold of anybody, if you're a club rep and you can't get hold of anybody within the club, or your coach is not answering, or you're trying to make a change, notify them that you can't come because you have COVID or whatever, here is some extra contact information. But each team also has their own contact information. So if you click on, let's say, 2013, 2012 Girls White within Hollywood, you can see that's Coach Gabby, there's another coach, there's a manager. And if I click on view team contact information, I will see all of the people who are part of that team with their phone numbers and with their email addresses. If anything is incorrect here, we do not control this. Your club controls this. I just saw that Gabby's phone number is wrong. So maybe Coach Gabby can contact me. She knows my number, and I can change the phone number that she has in here, because if you call that number, you'll never get hold of her. So again, that's on the clubs. And the other thing on the clubs that's very important, if you click on a club or their schedule, you will see all of the games that that club has. So Brazilian Soccer Training Center has a game this Saturday at 3 o'clock at Boggs Field, U8 Yellow. If they don't have this game, and I already signed referees, we'll talk. But otherwise, look at your schedule so you don't get caught off guard. We talked earlier, all of these games on December 25th, which is Christmas, are not real games. They're going to be played on Christmas. These are all the games that Michael needs to reschedule. Clubs that were not ready to start playing in December have a lot of games to schedule, and we have to do them by February 26th. So if you're a coach or team manager that can help your club, please do so, because these games are going to be put on the schedule. We talked about team brackets. Again, the only ones you can look up, any of them that you want, but the ones that we need players for are teams of U14 girls and U6 girls. And lastly, scoring input. If you want to score the game through here, you can type in the code. You can type in a code and you can score, and you can score any game. So if I type in game number 66, I can say that Hollywood Wildcats won the 0-8-1. I'm not going to do it, and push save. You can also report red cards here, but you could do this on your phone.
Yeah, but don't actually report the red card there and think you're reporting the red card. Actually, we need the rosters. So you're actually,
we need the roster for the game. If you score the game here and you send the red card here and you say that this kid Alexei had two yellows and you think you reported the red card, you didn't. We still need a roster itself. Okay, back to home. Within the schedule, females are separate from males. And the most important one we're going to have most confusion is U8s. This year, we are playing U8s as 7v7 and 4v4s. Except for the very few clubs who only chose to play 4v4, most of you will have some games in 7v7 division and some games in 4v4 division. So if you click on your schedule for the U7 girl boys gold, and you click on your team, and let's say 2014 boys red, these are not all the games you will play. These are just the games you will play within 7v7 division. You also have to, this is 2014 boys red, you also have to go to your 4v4 division gold and click on the exact same team, which is this one here, and you see that you have some more 4v4 games. We strongly recommend, but we do not force you to do so, to try and schedule it so that it's friendly for travel. If you can play a 7v7 game followed by the 4v4 game on the same field and be done and not have to travel again, great. If you can play your two 4v4 games back to back, one of the girls' teams just played Driftwood Dragons and they basically played two games, and I think it worked really well. There were two 4v4 games. Let's see if they were scored. Yep, they were scored. Just happened tonight. One game was at 6, one was at 7. It's referee friendly, it's driving friendly, and you're done in hour and a half. Back to the schedule. Couple of divisions have already had their playoffs scheduled. What does that mean? This division only has 5 teams. So we're not going to be breaking them up into top 3, bottom 2, most likely, unless there's like a real discrepancy in quality of play. If everything stays as is, this division was scheduled so that team number 5 at the end of the season plays team number 4 on Friday the 4th. The 4 teams go to semifinals on Saturday, and then the 2 winners go to finals on Sunday. We didn't do this for very many divisions because most of our divisions have a lot of teams and we don't know what's going to happen. So for example, in this U10 boys silver, we could play top 4, middle 4, bottom 4, or top 6, or top 2, next 6. We'll see what the score is like. But at the bottom of the schedule that we think we know what's going to happen with playoffs, you will see playoffs. If you don't see them there, they're probably going to happen closer to the end of the season.
If we have clubs that are new, because we have some new clubs here, in U10 and older, we're going to bracket and make playoff divisions at the end of the season. So Tom said it quickly. All of you will go to playoffs, and most of you will go to playoffs. If you have 12 teams, we might have top 4, next four. We may break you up after the fact, and you'll play for different divisions, different trophies within those divisions.
All right. So I'm going to quickly jump off of a public website that your parents can see and go into the private GodSport that only you, the coach or team manager, can see. When you log into your GodSport, I like to say godpro.com because I find that this way it's easier to just get straight to where you want to go. And you log into your account, you will probably take it to something like this. This is where you already did your background check and save sport and concussion. Sorry, I have a lot of clubs. But this is where you did your background check. So if you haven't done this, you don't have an account, you don't have access to your team. But if you have done this under team management, you will see all the teams that you're in charge of. It could be only one team, and that's okay. Most of you only have one team. On the matches tab, you will see all the games that your teams are playing. I'm going to narrow down to Greater Hollywood Soccer League, and I'm going to narrow down to those 2013-2012 girls again. And here is their schedule, and here is their chat functionality, and here's where you can print the match card. If your club, like Hollywood Wildcats does, provide you match cards for every week together with referee fees, then you might not need to do this. But if you need to, in emergency, print the match cards because the Thursday night practice rained out and you can't come to the field on Friday to pick up your game cards, you can do that from here. These two teams are scheduled to play on Thursday the 16th, and because this team is wearing gray, Gabby, correct me if I'm wrong, I'm going to go into chat and say, looking forward to our game, we'll wear gray uniforms. I'm sorry, my spelling. All right. And I know that this is going to go to 4 people within Hollywood Wildcats and 1 person within Pembroke Pines, Arcadia Simperville. So I'm assuming that's a coach because it says so. When I save this, Arcadia and Gabby and Mauro and Tom, whoever else is here, and the other Gabby, will all get a little notification on top right telling them that there's some kind of communication that has happened. They will also get an email that says, hey, you got a new message. It won't tell you what the message is, but if you log into your GodSport, you will see that there's messages in here for you to read. Let me see if I can find one. I'll just pull one from another league. I apologize. But so here is somebody saying the correction. Here is some chat about the game. You can also see the contact information here if you need to call somebody. I find that it's a good idea to put this phone number in your phone so that in case while you're driving to the game on a Friday evening and it's raining cats and dogs, you have a way of contacting the person without having to stop, pull aside and get into your GodSport. I know I flew through this really quickly. So again, when you log into your account from the dashboard, click on this person picture up here, go to team management, matches, and then work with whatever match you need to work on. Again, I'm sorry I have so many of them.
Something you said real quick about rain. We didn't mention that. Don't assume because it's raining or cold that your game is canceled. Check with your reps. We have a chat. We will tell them if parks close. We will often play in some rain. We'll often play in cold nights. So you still have to show up. If you're not, if you don't know if the game is on, if you don't show up and the game is on, it's a forfeit. So please, you know, don't assume a game is off because of weather.
If your contact information is not up to date on this website, that you are a rep of one of these clubs, or I don't have your logo, and I saw one logo emailed to me while we were doing this meeting, just send it to me and I'll update a website. We're going to be changing this website next year. This is the All Gods Soccer website, which we really need to get away from. But with everything else we're doing, we didn't have time to update it. So, Brian, did we have anything else? Or can we open it for questions?
Thankfully, this year, we didn't have 40 slides on COVID. But COVID has not gone away. FYSA has rules on COVID quarantines and COVID protocols. It's still use common sense, sharing equipment, those types of things. Your club should advise you on that. Where we care about it as a league is quarantines. If a player on your team tests positive for COVID-19, your team is on a hiatus. You're going to be out for, I believe it's 10 days. Tom, there might be a more recent slide on this. We'll have to post it. Do you just pull this up right now, or is this old?
Yeah, this is the only one they have, which is from August of this year.
I thought I saw a more recent one with slightly different dates. I think it's 10 days. We'll confirm it. If you have a COVID case on your team and it was in 3 days of the team being together, your team is not able to practice, play for 10 days. You can come back on the 11th day. So be aware of that. If you violate the COVID protocol, if you fail to report a case, if you have a known case and you choose to play in three games, your coaching for the season will come to an end. These are things, again, I don't want to sound condescending. I don't want to sound rude. This is what we're being told by FYSA. And our cities, the health department, we still have to follow these protocols. Please be honest. You know, if you have players that are sick, don't not get them tested because you don't want a negative test to take your team out. If somebody has every symptom of COVID and you choose not to test them, or a parent chooses not to test them, you better assume they have COVID. I mean, we're living in this reality now. And, you know, it is serious. You have liability if you become a super spreader. So remember, you have personal liability if you become a super spreader by doing something malicious or by overlooking something. So I'm not going to say any more on that. But remember, if you have a case of COVID, if it's reported to you, please, please, please tell your club reps. They know what to do. So make sure it goes up. And please don't bring sick kids. If you have a child who is sick and they rapid tested on their Binax Now CVS test, I keep them around, but they're clearly sick, don't bring them to a game. They may not have COVID. They may have a cold, but they also may have taken an over-the-counter test. So, and again, we're all in this together. This season can turn really crappy really fast if we have a lot of teams on being suspended. Not suspended, being quarantined for COVID. We went through this the first season. I had 15 teams in and out of quarantines. It hasn't been so bad lately, but please be on board with us and, you know, protect yourselves. Report your COVID cases. That's all I'm saying on COVID.
Hey, Brian, I'm trying to quickly look through the chats. There was a question about January 1st. Assume January 1st is the same as Christmas. There's no games on January 1st. They will move there for some reason, something to help us remember that we need to reschedule them. So, yeah, no, we're not playing on New Year's Day.
If you see a game at 7 a.m. anytime during the year, even a Saturday, it's not real. The system has a quirk. If we pull a game off the schedule, but don't take it off the day. So let's say it's a Saturday game. We unschedule it. We didn't put it on Christmas. The system, even though it's not on a field, it says TBD, it's still going to show 7 a.m. Question anything that's at 7 o'clock in the morning. It probably is not real.
7 p.m., yes. There are games at 7 p.m. So make sure that if you're playing a 7 p.m. game on a Friday, there's most likely a game. Yes, because
7 a.m. You know, on the business is probably not real. It's not real.
I am trying to go through questions. I don't see any more except to stop eating. Okay, so I'll open it up for questions. Let's do it by raising the hand in Zoom so that we don't all talk on top of each other. And then I think there's one hand raised, and that is from Tom's iPhone. So, Tommy, is that you?
Yeah, but it was earlier. You answered it.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, great. Anybody else? Gotta be some questions after all that.
I'm sure we forgot something.
I see.
Tola Gani Ogun, go ahead.
Greetings, how are you?
Great, thank you.
Good. I got a quick question as far as the tournament. When you see the tournament, because I had a question last year and I noticed there was something a little off. When you have six seeds in a tournament. Number one and number two had a bye. So three played number six and four and five played. If you have an upset, do you allow the lower seed to play the top seed, or is it just final? You keep it the way how it is.
Okay, so first of all, you said tournament, you mean playoffs.
Playoffs, correct. I'm sorry, playoffs.
What is the question? So yeah, so if there's a 16 playoff bracket, number one and two move on to next round, and then the next four are treated as if one plays four, two plays three. So what is the question?
So now my question is, if you have an upset, because you set the playoff seeding based off of records, and you have the lower seed play the higher seed. But in the second round of the playoffs, if the lower seed beats the higher seed, if the higher seed beat the lower seed, higher seed? I mean, do they play the lower seed in the next round?
We create like mini divisions. If we have four teams, we may take four, four, and four. Like, and actually those four will go play gold, silver, bronze. Those are like actually segregated now for the rest of the playoffs. So those top four are going to play each other.
So when I started playing in Greater Hollywood Soccer League, this section about playoffs, number three, used to be very, very long and very, very specific. And it caused problems. So now it basically says playoff seeding will be determined by the executive board depending on the number of teams participating, because there were so many specifics that sometimes we made mistakes that we were basically violating our own rules. So the board and the membership decided, you know what, we're going to have to see what happens as we get there. I think the answer to your question is semifinals are already decided where one goes and where two goes. And then what happens in a quarterfinals, you're just filling in those empty spots. So I don't think there's any changes in whatever you talked about.
Okay. It just was confusing because during the first round, you see the playoffs based off of your seeding, meaning number one, number one and number two gets a bye, and then three, number three plays number six, and four and five play. But if number six beats number three, then you allow them to play the number two team, whereas it's the sixth seed, so they should naturally play the number one seed.
Well, and no, the seeding is only to put the brackets together. Once we seed the teams and we launch the playoffs, those seedings don't matter anymore. Now it's brackets. So they're going to move through a flow chart. I mean, if I'm explaining that right, we're not going to change the outcome of a final just because of an upset. If an upset happens,
Okay.
I mean, the other thing you have to understand is when that number one or number two was told you're going to have semifinals on a Friday, we really can't change schedules on them last minute because we found out on a Thursday in quarterfinals something happened that was an upset. But thank you for your question. Michael, you're next. Michael Guarin?
Yeah, my question is, you were saying about now with COVID and all that, how everything's changing. Are the referees allowing the coaches to have digital passes, or do they have to be like physical paper passes?
They still have to be laminated passes because that's not up to us. It's up to Florida Youth Soccer Association. As you know, we've been trying to get virtual passes allowed for years, but it just isn't happening. Let's keep trying hard. Right now, virtual passes in the new gods sport doesn't work properly anyway, because it would never be a PDF file on your phone. It would have to be something that works, that feeds from the database. It would never be you having pictures on your phone that you just slide through that you could have Photoshopped. So right now, the virtual passes do not really work, even if we wanted them to work. So it's not a fight we want to have this year. But let's hope that if virtual passes get fixed, that we can actually use it. Because in the old system, it was a really good way to do it, but they didn't let us use it.
Okay. Somebody has a question online. Is there a procedure if referees don't show up? Doesn't happen often, but yes, the home team did assign the referee. We want the kids to play, right? So if the referees don't show up, we're not going to give a forfeit. You only need one referee on an 11v11 game. You don't need three refs. It could be if one ref shows up, that ref can play, can do the game. So typically, if we have multiple games going, we're going to pull a ref off of another game. We could be down a linesman. If we're down a linesman, you don't have to pay that linesman. Tom put up the chart showing you on a U14 game, you're bringing $50. $30 is going to the linesman, two of them. And $25 is going to, if it will
happen. No, you're bringing $55.
You're bringing 50, right? Okay, right. Tom, I'm explaining, you're bringing 55 total. You can deduct a linesman fee of $30, if a linesman doesn't show
15%.
Up. 15%. You deduct 15, right, half of it. So if no referees show up and there's literally you're there and there's no refs, we're going to then reschedule the game.
On the opposite team.
On your field, right. So if you went to Davey and Mike Weber didn't send, or the soccer signer failed to send the referees over to Davey, we're going to move that game to your field. We're going to move it back to Driftwood. It's your home game now. And when Davey comes, they're going to pay both sides of the ref fees. So they're going to pay the full thing. And we're going to move it. If you choose to, we're going to move it to your field. That didn't happen a lot
because most of us have multiple games. And like you said, so when I was updating this this chart, I almost took it out because it's a very confusing chart. So I apologize, but it was there and I kind of kept it. For the most part, the gray section shouldn't have to happen. This is if you are short referees. To be honest with you, I almost interrupted Brian when he was talking earlier about if parents don't behave, what happens to the coach? The number one reason why you're going to be using this gray section is because we all have a huge shortage of referees. So you're probably going to go through a number of games this season where you're not going to have a full crew. And you're just going to either have to get used to it.
It's going to happen. It's going
to
happen.
Yeah, I mean, you're either going to have to get used to it or send some kids to become referees. There's just a shortage everywhere. And so if you're short referees, your coach should be coming home with some money. There should be some leftover money.
Right.
Right. As long as there's at least one referee there to run a game, we need the game played.
Right. I'm going to mention one thing on referees. We call our playoffs the Mike Weber Cup. And our playoff series is Mike Weber Cup because Mike Weber, who passed away a few years back, was like a guy who's been in soccer forever. He was our ref assigner. Everybody knew him. And to honor him, we called it the Mike Weber Cup. Mike Weber gave the speech on referees every year. And we're lacking that speech. Tom is a referee signer himself. I'm going to give it real quick. Just remember that these referees are your kids. If a lot of you who are coaching now are coaching young athletes who will become referees. We're using a lot of young refs. We're using a lot of new referees. Some of them are going to be older adults. Some won't be. Some of them are going to be underqualified and overqualified for these recreational games. They're going to make mistakes. You're not going to like their calls sometimes, but you have to accept their calls. So when you have that urge to tell the ref where to go or have words with the referee, I want you to think that you could be talking to your son or your daughter, because I'm seeing a lot of faces on this call. I see Jose, I see Tom, my own son's behind me, and I see other people on here. I know that their sons and daughters are referees. So just please keep that in mind, that these are kids, these are people, and they're not perfect. And that's it. And they're not getting paid a fortune for abuse. You know,
Tommy. Sorry.
That's all I'm gonna say on refs.
Tommy, do you have a question, Tommy?
Yeah. Is there three refs for the sorry, my thing wasn't clear the whole time. I'm out on the field picking up crap. But anyway, for the little ones, one ref's good enough, right?
It's not just good enough. It specifically specifies one ref. So unlike some leagues like, bring one, bring two, bring three, 4v4, it's only one referee. We raised the fees this year in order to help us actually get referees there because they were taking other league games. So we are kind of in line with South Florida United, except they don't have any 4v4. So we are in line. We hopefully
probably. Rising U9, the UA playing in the Rising U9, that's a one ref. Also, it's a one ref situation in those games, and he's not calling offsides. So that's a game with keepers, one referee. Once you get to U10 and you're playing those games and older, except for maybe the high school 5v5, it's all going to be three referees all the way up.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure for the 4v4 what was
that's going on. That's one ref.
Yep. One ref.
Okay, good. Thank you. That makes sense.
Any other questions? By the way, our meeting has concluded. If you don't want to be here anymore, you don't have to be here anymore. But if you have questions, we're more than glad to answer them.
Yeah, we're going to post this too.
So. And then after today, you can ask questions from your reps.
Yes, anybody, if you don't have a question, you can, you know. But if you have any questions, stay on. If you want to hear the answers, stay on. I don't see anything else in the chat. Is there anybody else has a hand up in there? Is there somebody that has something in chat that I'm missing? Because I don't think so.
I don't think so.
Okay, I mean, we're not disappearing. Like I said, your club reps all know what's going on and they all can get answers from us. So reach out if you have questions. Don't be shy. If you need to know what a build out line is, we get this is rec. A lot of you are new. Don't be overwhelmed. Ask the questions and your club reps will help you. Those slide presentations are online. Everything's on YouTube. Everything's on YouTube. So if you need to know how to work a build out line, what the rules are, just go to YouTube. Make sure you're looking at a real source, though. Something that looks like it was produced by a soccer association would be better than just some random video. But there's a lot of resources that are out there. There's coaching license opportunities. You're highly encouraged to do that. It's called Grassroots. It's basically online. You could go to fysa.com and you can jump on these courses. Some of them are in person. You can do them online as well. It's really a good idea to take coaching courses if you're in this for the long run. You want to better yourself. A lot of clubs will pay for those courses. PPO will pay for them. They teach you a lot about the psychology of coaching more than the technical of coaching. How a 10-year-old thinks, right? How to interact with a 10-year-old in a way they understand. So we really, really encourage you to take coaching courses. If you're a PPO coach, I'll help you with those. So just contact me. You know, there's different courses out there. And
there is a D license course at my field in Hollywood, starting January through March. That's a D license. Yeah,
he's
that's
a high level. That's more. Hey,
is that still open?
Yes, it's open. Well, it hasn't been open yet. Right now, it's by invitation only, but it's going to open any day now if it's not already all open.
Right. Let me call you, Tate. Bye.
All right.
Thank you very much. By the way, you guys did a very good job.
Thanks, Tom. Anybody else have a question? If not, we'll kill it and we'll turn it into a YouTube video. We'll put it online.
I am stopping the share and I'm stopping the recording so we can start cursing. Hold on.
Okay, we'll stop the recording. Everyone can see.